Well, I would very much like to begin by thanking Brian for the very kind remarks. We're also thanking the provost and for thanking Henry for his very generous introduction. He's very kind. I feel very humbled and I feel very touched. And I am very happy to be among all of you in such a great intellectual community, among distinguished scholars and the Northwestern MENA community at large. A way of introduction. We are here today, and in fact, I am here today because this is a long journey, as Professor Beenan touched upon it. It all began in Princeton, actually in Liechtenstein, and if my memory served me well, it was around October or November of 1992. And we began discussing the Middle East and how to foster a program at Princeton that would promote cutting-edge research on the region, so the discovery of knowledge and the transmission of knowledge, and in the process, foster understanding that would serve the people of the region and also campuses and communities in the United States. That effort and that undertaking, thanks to the generous sacrifices and the generous input of many people, many scholars and many friends. At Princeton to begin with, yourself, Professor Abdallah, friend and professor, John Waterbury, and other people, began there, and we nourished that effort to englobe other people with a spirit of partnership. And we built this modest foundation, which seeks for itself to promote dissemination of understanding, of research, and fostering of understanding of the Middle East. We'd like to think that our only criteria and our main core criteria are intellectual rigor, intellectual independence, total independence, because there cannot be any generation of serious knowledge without independence, and that any debate and any exchange we have happens in the medium of respect, mutual respect. It's sometimes very hard, of course, because as you know, many of the fundamental issues can be controversial and polemical. This brings us to this conference, when 2 years ago, I believe, Brian and I were discussing the region, and we were discussing Northwestern's effort to build a global center on the Middle East and area studies on the Middle East. And I saw in this, because it was a founding moment, the inaugural conference, that any founding moment can have structuring impact and foundational impact for the future. And we decided to very modestly, this is very modestly and humbly, to contribute to that. And today I am very honored and pleased to see this conference materialize with all of you participating. I'd like to thank everybody and also all the staff of MENA, and especially Tim, finding my bed, which I lost twice. Thank you very much. I had an important notebook in it. You're my lifesaver. Thank you. So on this, I will begin my brief talk. And I really felt very much humbled by the breadth and the depth of all this groundbreaking research that we discovered here, and that we're reminded of how much there is to develop and how much there is to seek for understanding the governing dynamics of the Middle East today. As Brian suggested, I want to offer more modest remarks from the different perspective as a practitioner, one who interacts with states and societies in the region, very much like yourselves, but from a different perspective. to try and seek an understanding of the problems that confront us. My observations are not necessarily specialized in a purely academic sense. However, I think they reflect what I believe are the major challenges that lie ahead as we seek to imagine a more peaceful, a more prosperous, and a more stable region. Those challenges, of course, include the counter-revolutionary impulse of authoritarian states, the open-ended nature of the revolutionary process that is unfolding, and the geopolitics, and the sectarian nexus of what we call Daesh in our region, or ISIS, or ISIL. The particular slant of my talk is all the more appealing in the fact that one of our panelists, and the inaugural in the first table was not here, Sean Young, and he was going to address authoritarian durability and authoritarian dynamics. His absence makes this talk fill in that gap, at least partially. So let me begin first with the deep states and the authoritarian impulse towards counter-revolution. Many of the authoritarian states of the Arab world today, I would say, resemble what Jean-Pierre Philippe, the French political scientist, called Mamluk states. Mamluks, as you know, were originally slave soldiers employed by the Abbasid dynasty, and they have been taken from non-Arab lands. Because they were not Arabs, leaders and caliphs could trust that they were not torn between conflicting loyalties between tribes, families, and other social groupings. And over the centuries, however, this Mamlukian group developed into a class, developed a very strong sense of asabiyya being an esprit de corps, eventually military power, until they took full control of the Abbasid state in the 12th century. Mamluks thus wielded an authoritarian imperative to monopolize the state without being deeply connected to the societies they ruled, which effectively made them invulnerable to threats except outside invasions. Mamlukian impulse, which is highly patrimonial and autocratic, underlines many of the republics of the Arab world, such as Syria and Egypt, to give an example. These actors are themselves, they feel they have a mandate, guardians of the state, and have ultimate political authority, yet they also believe that they are impervious from their own societies due to their mandate and to their what they perceive as legitimacy. They have interiorized within themselves this mandate to act as authoritarian trustees that stand above society. In some Arab states, this impetus, of course, is born with the founding moments of post-colonial independence, and especially in Egypt, it is reborn again a second time, as you know, the Mamluks also were important players there. They are reborn, of course, with the Dawla Madaniya and the administrative reforms of Mohammed Ali Pasha in the 19th century. Their instinct upon witnessing popular uprisings was to defend their mandate at all costs and ensure that the state apparatus did not fall into the hands of social forces they saw as inferior to themselves. In Egypt, President Mubarak was toppled by a revolution in 2011, as you know, but the Sisi coup against the elected Muslim Brotherhood government in 2013 revealed that the military's fear that their institutional prerogatives were under threat. In Syria, as you know, the brutal way that the Assad regime attacked the first peaceful protest basically conditioned events afterwards. What started out as peaceful protest eventually became militarized precisely because of this Mamlukian response using force and brutality. In the broader sense, then, this defensive mentality is reflected in how all enduring autocracies in the Arab world have interpreted popular protests and demands as something simply unacceptable. As a further complication, after the first phase of the Arab Spring, enter what we all call geopolitics. Geopolitical factors have reinforced this counter-revolutionary strategy. The counter-revolutionary push against democracy morphed at the same time in what became a Sunni Shiite sectarian divide. On the one hand, you had the inflated threat of Shia expansionism has allowed Sunni regimes to paint much of their domestic opposition and radical and extremist and to justify increased control. I think the example for this, of course, early on in the Arab Spring was the events in Bahrain, where a Sunni regime and a political establishment have portrayed mass opposition, challenging that regime as an Iranian and as a Shia fifth column. In reality, the Bahraini opposition was not that. It has a long history since the independence of Bahrain, since it gained independence of the UN, in the context of a UN-organized referendum of demanding change and wanting a parliamentary regime. The inverse also, of course, happened in Syria at about simultaneously the same time. And here, regime backed by Iran claimed that the opposition was part of a wider Sunni plot to impose hegemony on the region. So threatening did they portray this Sunni conspiracy that the coalition associated with the Assad regime is not purely a Shia one. It is, of course, a coalition of minorities. This is how one should look at it. And it included the Alawites in Syria, it included the Hezbollah in Lebanon, and the Yemeni Houthis. Since the advent of the Arab Spring, we have entered into a new sectarian paradigm of Sunni-Shiite divide, and punctuated by different episodes, punctuated by different inflection points. And the latest inflection points are, just to cite the latest one, the most recent one, was the fall of oil prices precipitated by Saudi Arabia to defend its oil strategy and also to destabilize or to weaken the capability of Iran to project its power in the region, and also the striking of the U.S.-Iranian nuclear deal. And both of these actions or these inflection points, we have yet to know how the consequences will play out. In another scenario, or in another setting, Egypt, a restored military regime, has conflated the Muslim Brotherhood, which had previously renounced violence and participated in elections. It has conflated that movement with violence and terrorism. Repressions against the Islamists, of course, have been the harshest they have ever been since the 1950s, with most of the leadership either in jail or in exile. Strategy of terror against terrorism, however, has a circular logic. Terrorism provokes counter-reactions and permits the Egyptian regime to say, look, this is the proof that our strategy is working. There is terrorism, this is a fight against terrorism. And the message is basically, either be governed or be killed by us. Geopolitical gamble is that fears of terrorism and jihadism spreading in the region will make the Western a landslide and even will dampen the ardor of militants and popular demands for change. Ironically, however, many of these autocracies play a double game with terrorism, attacking opposition at home, but also enforcing certain policies which encourage certain form of jihadism and extremism in the region. Let me give you examples. For instance, in Libya, the Western-backed forces of General Haftar, who was part of the old Libyan regime, Gaddafi regime, have rarely, if not never, attacked ISIS, which is based in Derna in Libya, and prefer attacking the Trablus, the Tripoli government. The same thing in Syria, as I said. All the focus on the repression beginning or in the beginning of the Arab Spring, was against so-called seculars. And in fact, the Assad regime notoriously freed many radical elements from jail and encouraged them to take on the insurrection. In Yemen, the government has proclaimed the Houthis as terrorists, but on the other hand, has sought to deal and to negotiate with Al-Qaeda in the Arab Peninsula in favor of a truce. And finally, in the Gulf, regimes declare and see Daesh, rightfully so, as dangerous was a priority number one, but at the same time restrain or constrain very little, very minimum NGOs, local NGOs, which funnel financing to many Islamist networks, which then funnel them in turn to extremist groups. So in sum, this is a double discourse that shows how regimes are serious in attacking terrorism only when they are faced with it as a threat directly, but do not see or refuse to see the wider implications, and also use this as an ever-ending justification or an alibi to postpone change. Let me say a word about, this is about the authoritarian tactics, let me say a word about the revolutionary processes which are in play. I think we had long discussions on this during the last days, and especially yesterday in the keynote that we had yesterday about are these revolutions, are these not revolutions, how can we read them? Well, my idea is as follows, you know, for better or for worse, people declare that the Arab Spring has ended, with Tunisia being the only real success story. Arab regimes also make the same claim, that essentially the uprisings have failed and that everything they've created or everything they've brought about was only chaos and violence. Yet the lack of revolutionary explosions today do not mean that revolutionary processes have stopped. The structural dynamics and economic processes that caused the first wave of popular insurrections remain identical, if not worse, than they were in 2010. Unemployment rates in most Arab countries are virtually the same, if not higher, with most economies still burdened by large public sectors and very small and anemic private sectors. Societies still feature very large and rapidly growing youth populations, which are overwhelming and straining services and economic opportunities offered by governments and the private sector. Educational systems are still based on credentials and diplomas rather than on merit, and turn out, produce people with very little competence and skills to be able to be absorbed by or integrated in the local economy, let alone in a globalized and competitive economy. And above all, political regimes continue to deny citizens a meaningful voice in policymaking, especially when it comes to the distribution of resources. There is still an unhealthy collusion between politics and economics, with basically a strong overlap between small cliques of elites dominating both politics and economics. The myth of developmentalism has been shattered because increased growth as measured by empty statistics and GDP seldom translates into trickle-down effects and real distribution of economic fruits. Other socio-economic problems include worsening inequality and endemic corruption. Yet while these structural problems have not changed, something has changed. The social and cultural fabric of Arab societies have irrevocably shifted in a new direction, and everyday citizens are no longer in fear and awe of the authoritarian states. Yes, something has happened. The spell of authoritarianism has been broken. That fear is not there anymore. But there's another kind of fear. There's a fear of exhaustion. Many people may have become convinced that genuine reform is impossible. The fear comes from the spread, as we said, of Daesh and jihadism, as well as the slow collapse of states like Syria and Yemen. The exhaustion comes from failed efforts to install new democratic governments and the defeat of old autocracies. So, broken bones do create demoralization, but demoralization or fear also stems from the feeling of being outmaneuvered and outfoxed by the state, like in situations in Morocco or in Jordan. And it also comes from the failure for democratic activists in other states to translate reform concessions by regimes into real institutional gains. Such disappointment from the first revolutionary uprisings may also have induced apathy and, in many cases, a de facto support for regimes. I say de facto. In the same way, the fear and exhaustion and apathy are only temporary states of mind. We know that this will eventually turn into restlessness and into more or further mobilization. The very failure of authoritarian governments to enact credible reforms was what caused the initial Arab uprising. So the choice for these regimes, of course, is to reform or face revolt in the future. But the question is, can these regimes reform? The question posed itself before the Arab Spring. Could these regimes have reformed, seriously reformed? Could many of the autocrats, if confronted with the right strategies, have found for themselves a way to extricate themselves from power or pact with opposition groups and led their countries in a transition process? So I guess what I'm hinting at is that there's a path dependency here, which is not completely addressed, not fairly addressed by all of us watching the region. I will give you a few examples, very few, I think that demonstrate that these processes are very much still very vibrant under the surface, and they can prop up and they can come up on the radar screen anytime, anywhere, and they are very diverse and eclectic, yet they are not ubiquitous. In Lebanon, for example, mass protests exploded starting in the summer in response to the government's inability to collect trash and the general sanitary conditions of the country. These demonstrations, as you know, mobilized across ethnic divisions and across sectarian lines, and it was a continuation of the civil movement in the same country against the confessional system that many people see as outdated. Instead of a civil society or civic order, it favors instead a more democratic system that puts all citizens upon an equal playing field, rather than the artificial sectarian formulas which elites have been so good at engineering to perpetuate their own positions. In Algeria, an environmental protest movement mobilized in rural areas last spring to block hydraulic fracturing for shale gas. These activists rallied against the government project despite the perceived and the very real benefits that this project could bring, and this due to the specter of destruction and pollution from fracking. This, of course, for me is an example by itself, because we can trace the origins of the Arab Spring, in my opinion, beyond 2011 or farther back. For instance, in the events in Algeria in 1988, long before the self-immolation of Mohamed Bouazizi. In other words, the fact we choose 2011 is, in a sense, rather arbitrary, because many of these processes were happening sporadically across the region. We could say that the Algerian uprisings of 1988 were the beginning of the Arab Spring. We could also say that the events in Sudan just after that were part of that trigger. We could say, of course, that the Intifada, although it's a context of opposition, very much resembled or very much was a kind of preamble of the Arab Spring. This, of course, led to the events we know, the rise of the Islamic Front, Salvation Front, grassroots mobilization for change, violent seizure of the military power, and the resulting civil war. These contemporary episodes of mobilization proved the most fundamental idea that I guess I want to communicate, namely that popular resistance against the state can result in meaningful change, and that it still resonates very powerfully in the region. What major lessons learned from the first years of the Arab Spring, however, is that political change requires more than just moments of mobilization. Real meaningful change requires from activists, revolutionaries, and visionaries to organize, to craft coalitions, to think strategically and always, if not have an answer, always map out the forces that are in play and what to do if your adversary comes up with a move. What would you do next? what's after that. It's exactly like in chess. And this, like our keynote speaker yesterday, was very much lacking in the mobilization of the Arab Spring, because most of these movements, as many of us or many of you yesterday noted, were leaderless. They had an aversion to hierarchy and to organization. The failures of the Egyptian opposition to develop these strategies, for instance, after its brief victory in 2011, resulted in the consequent return to authoritarian power by the army. However, it must be remembered that while most protest movements committed these mistakes during the first wave of the Arab Spring, with the exception of Tunisia, of course, it is very probable and most likely that the lesson has been learned and that actors will perform better next time around. So to conclude, I would like to say, yes, there is no doubt, and it is comfortable to say that after the democratic high watermark of the Arab Spring, we are now facing an authoritarian riptide, as autocratic forces have attempted and have successfully restored their supremacy in many of these settings. However, history also tells us that revolutionary waves are cyclical and that popular demands for dignity and freedom will emerge again. Now, a word about this new animal or this new beast that has come onto the scene, and that is very much structuring politics in the region, and namely Daesh. So I'd like to conclude with a few words on Daesh and the implications of Daesh and what the new landscape that has emerged with the birth of Daesh. Another major reason for believing that the Arab Spring, of course, has ended lies within the rise of ISIS, which implicates both the weakness of existing states as well as destructive influences of geopolitics. To understand Daesh, I think we must not neglect and we must address the deficiencies of the state formation process and political governance that existed prior to the Arab Spring. It is ironic that Daesh flourishes in Syria and Iraq because for decades, both were heralded by scholars as the archetype of the durable coercive state and the unitary state that seemed shielded from any challenge by virtue of its domination over society. While the radical beliefs of Daesh represent a new phase in the ideology of jihadism, the raw human materials required for its growth were already in place before the Arab Spring. In Syria, the initial expansion of Daesh required not just for recruits, but also substantial local support. Those bases of support existed because the original project of Syrian statehood never completed its most basic goal, that of serving Syrians. A different yet similar parallel dynamic is at work in Iraq, where Daesh has drawn upon disenfranchised Sunni communities that have been underserved, or actually, that's a misnomer, that have been brutalized and marginalized by the old Shia-dominated government of Maliki. Maliki's regime made use of Maliki's government because that regime was in place after the invasion, the 2003 occupation of Iraq. Maliki's government made use of Shia militias that suppressed and brutalized much of the population, cannibalized the state and the Iraqi army. In this way, Daesh can be seen as not only an external impetus, but also an internal response to this repression. Daesh may or may not be an offspring of Al-Qaeda, or simply a digression or a displacement of Al-Qaeda, but it has notable differences with Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda held that the only legitimate form of jihad was military attack, military offensive, and there was no notion of holding territory or building state institutions. I guess state institutions is also an inappropriate word. Building, I should say, government capabilities or pockets of government capacity. The vision of Al-Qaeda was a nomadic, apocalyptic, and globalized network of fighters who saw military struggle as an unending obligation that would extend far beyond their lifetime. For recruits joining such an organization required commitment, credentials, and experience in a complex initiation process. It was all very difficult and all cloaked in total secrecy. By contrast, Daesh believes the fruits of struggle lie in the present, not in the afterworld or in the future, and that in the end prioritizes the creation of a natural territorial entity. Daesh seeks to hold land, build pockets of governance and wage jihad within the confines of geography and the present. Its membership model resembles an open call for recruits in which any committed supporter can join without a deep layer of secrecy. In addition, unlike the virtual networks of Al-Qaeda, Daesh has become a biological enterprise in seeking to establish a stable population to underpin its status aspirations. It is attracting many women and emphasizing the creation of new family units, however coerced or manipulated they may be. Thus, a very specific view of a Sunni state building that competes with other Sunni forms of legitimacy. And this is why it is seen by many Sunni regimes, or by all Sunni regimes, as a danger. Daesh also sees violence and its inclination not merely a means to an end, but the goal itself and the natural extension of its ideology. In addition, Daesh would also see ever-growing efforts by outside powers to intervene and manipulate local events. That is, in addition to the sectarian divide, the Arab Spring has now evolved into other actors, a third layer of actors that have intervened. Russia's military intervention and potentially in Iraq is not only connected or is not connected with Daesh. Daesh is the alibi. It must be contextualized part of its broader geopolitical ambitions. Direct involvement in the Middle East conflicts is part of a gradual resurgence, as you know, of Russian military power since the fall of the Soviet Union. Supporting the Assad regime in Syria also gives Russia more bargaining, leveraging power for maneuvering space in Ukraine. Unlike the US and Europe, however, we cannot say that Syria has a great and grand strategy. If anything, it does not have a strategy. Now, the West has a strategy, but it does not have the means of a strategy or the stomach of that strategy. I mean, I'm not saying this as being haranguing or an adjutant. It's just that where the West does not have the resolve and has a strategy, Russia has the resolve but does not have a strategy or has an unrealistic strategy. Russia sees the Assad regime or wants to make of the Assad regime a sanctuary regime, a little like the regime in Afghanistan, the Najibullah regime, and as such dictate an exit for Assad eventually and a final solution for the Syrian crisis. I don't think that partition, even if the Russian strategy is concentrated on the Alawite region, I don't see this as a way of partitioning the country. Russia also identifies this regime, as I said, as a sanctuary and intends to obstruct any Saudi or US plan to impose its own endgame in Syria. It renews a very, very traditional way of seeing the region, which is through the lens of different ethnic groups and national identities rather than juridical states. One last word. The Iraqi government has gradually retreated from having an Iraqi national agenda that supports the integration of Sunnis. So here lies the conundrum for Russia. Even if it would like to absorb or to integrate Iraq into this umbrella, regional umbrella, the problem is that it will exacerbate the problems by making the Sunnis even more aggrieved and by making it, or by by exposing itself to what can be an insurgency against Russia, very much resembling what happened in Afghanistan. So it is playing a very dangerous game. But you have to understand also, we have to understand that, that Russia does not have the same vulnerabilities that a bomb or a terrorist attack in a Western city will have incredible implications on any elected government. It will not be the case, of course, for the Putin cabinet or government if there is a bombing in the Moscow subway. If anything, it may even strengthen its hand in its context. Another actor which has emerged, who has basically kind of on top of this edifice and seeing Daesh as a self-serving alibi, is Turkey. Turkey originally began as a member of the Sunni Arab Coalition, backing the West and backed by the West against the Assad regime, and framed Daesh as an existential threat. However, more recently, Turkey has used the threat of Daesh as an alibi to attack unilaterally the PKK in Syria and Iraq, which runs counter to the detente previously reached between the Turkish government and the same organization. The logic behind, of course, such a strategy is primarily domestic. Having failed in establishing what he sees as a new and unrestrained mandate to run Turkey, it would seem that the AKP or Erdogan in particular has resorted to this strategy to polarize and strengthen his electoral position. Whether that ultimately works or not, I remain very dubious, and I would like to end on that note. Thank you very much.